السلام عليكم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. And welcome all in this podcast about wound care, which wound care that you can use and what are the rationale for using or treating any wounds in general. This is Abdul Karim Blasi and thank you very much for being with us. The concept of wound care in many places and for many occasions, it's a weird concept. When you hear the word that reflect the meaning of the wound care, what is the wound care? Is it something simple so any nurse can do it, or it's needing a specialized person that able to understand what are the priorities to follow up? All of these are part from the logical questions. I will give you an example of my experience before. In one day, in one of the ICU units, I received a call that there is a disaster in that unit. The wound care plan that we put it was getting worse, and I get confused. What are the problems that they mean about the treatment of the wound care? Before that, I remember that all the wounds was doing fine. Not perfect, but at least within the progress. But in that day, they inform us that all the wounds get bad smell and there are problems associated with these wounds as it's all getting worse. After investigation, we discover that the nurse responsible about putting the dressing get confused between two types of dressings. Almost I covered just only to protect its part from the company, but all the wounds was almost identical except by the name, and they are doing in a contradicted work. They are both working in a different way, rather than the shape of packages are also the same. One of these containing a silver and used as antimicrobial, which was intended for the treatment. And the second one was collagen and it's used to promote the wound healing. What was the problem? Nurses get mistakes in understanding the difference between these two types and get vice versa in the use. As a consequence on the wound condition, instead of killing the bacteria, we were give them food to feed that bacteria. That mean more worst condition happen for the wounds based on that. The idea that I would like to take to talk about it, it was apart from the investigation happen, one of the doctors was in the meeting for understanding what was going on, and he said, I don't think it's a big deal, as the wound care in general, all are following the same rationale. If the wound was wet, if wet, make it dry, and if dry, make it wet. This is true if we are talking before 2003. What happened in 2003 until this already make the change? This is a picture of Dr. Grigori Schultz, and he was with other team responsible about in 2003 responsible to create a concept of called wound bed preparation. What is wound bed preparation? This is what we want to discuss and clarify within this podcast. This is the paper that they publish. Those are the experts worked on, and all of them already in a key figures in the wound, and maybe many of the people who are interested in the wound care, they know about Dr. Schultz, Gary Sibbles, Elizabeth Ilo, and the others, Keith Hardings, Marco Romanli. They suggest a new rationale for dealing with the wounds. This rationale called wound bed preparation. And the title of the paper, A Systematic Approach to Wound Management. They try to revise the evidence that's available at that time, and they try to put it in a frame that make it easy for anyone would like to deal with this concepts, with this condition. And after that, the wound bed preparation transferred from being in a concept to be in a theory. Of course, this is passing through very hard challenges, But at the end, the concept of wound bed preparation became now the theory, as it start to be more easy, more understandable by the people who are already working in the wound care domain. The structured framework that for the wound bed preparation suggests acronym called TIME, T-I-M-E. While we are dealing with the wounds based on the tissue condition, inflammation, infection, moisture imbalance, epithelial edge advancements. This is how the figure already for the ideas come from the time, tissue, infection, moisture, epithelization. So again, what are these terms and what are the meaning of management of each of these circles? The value of this theory already getting popularity, let's say, and the clinical practice. This is a part from my presentation in one of the conferences, where we try to summarize the important rules of time on the changes happen in the nursing.
To deal with the wound bed preparation theoretical framework. For that, there are follow-up for the progress of the wounds, and this will be a continuous process for the wound bed preparation. What are these processes in the wound bed preparation? As all of you know, that the wound bed preparation starts about the tissue management, how we will manage the bad tissues, that's the thing that we are not want like to see, on the same time, managing the infection with other wounds, and the inflammation, infection control, on the same time, following by M, which is moisture balance within the wound, and E, epithelialization or edge advancements, which is converts to T-I-M-E or time. That means the nursing role will work in each one of these in the comprehensive manner to deal with all of these aspects from, we will discuss from our perspectives as nurses. We know that the nursing are the cornerstone of the healthcare system. There is no hospitals or no healthcare system can work without the nurses. But at the same time, we are talking about an efficiency in performing these tasks by proper evaluation and by proper management of these conditions of the wounds. At the same time, within these consequences, failure of nurses to manage the wounds will contradict all the healthcare system works. Why?
Even before we create the concept of wound care nurse, before that, there are some responsibilities come on the nurses, how they are doing.
From a famous study, which is uncovered the latest techniques in the wound bed preparation, which is published in 2003, they start with the definitions of the wound bed preparation. What is wound bed preparation? They say that it's a multiple step procedures necessary to restore the chronicity of the wounds and move them toward healing. This is based on the Hess and Krenzler. In the same way, in 2002, which is the beginning of the wound bed preparation, what are the role of the nurse in the wound bed preparation? And this is the key cornerstone in all our perspectives to define what is the wound bed preparation and we as nurses, what is our main responsibility to deal with these set of procedures. They define five key tasks for the nurses, for the wound bed preparation and the nursing roles in the wound bed preparation. Achievements, management of necrosis, in the management of exudates, in the management of bacterial burden, and correction of cellular dysfunction and enhance the healthy granulation. The same again in 2007, they revised in the Art and Science for the Tissue Viability Journal differences between acute and chronic wounds and the role of the wound bed preparation from the nursing perspectives. And they define the wound bed preparation as a procedural care to eliminate the factors that delay the wound healing, based on Fletcher 2008. Then, where we are in this part of the wound bed preparation, we know that the wound bed preparation is a multiple step, and it's also a dynamic process, and it started from the patient.
What is the concern in dealing with the wounds? In general, we are looking to choose the correct dressing, and we would like to make this decision of choosing the wound dressing or the proper wound choice easy for the people to follow. The first things in this acronym is a tissue management, or in other words, we wanted to manage or remove unwanted tissue. This example of unwanted tissue, this black tissues here, this slough or yellow tissues here, these tissues already stop the ability of the wound to heal, minimize the chance of closing. Also, it will formulate in a proper area for the bacteria to develop and for bacteria to stay on the wound and colonized and make the situation worse. This is documents. I will refer you also for anyone interested to read. I think it's published 2016. It's a wound bed preparation, and they give an important update, facilitate for what are the evidence reached in this theory and the application of this theory. How we will manage the tissue or unwanted tissue. From the beginning idea for classifying priorities, the main priorities in the T is removing this unwanted tissue. How we will remove this unwanted tissue? Of course, all will discuss about surgical. In some references, they say sharp debridement, or we will remove it by knife. The second is otolytic, chemical, larva, mechanical, hydrosurgery, and ultrasonic. This is what come in the evidence. In many cases, surgical debridement is the golden standard. That very nice to bring the blade and start to remove this bad tissue so we can transfer this wound from this condition to this condition. But there are two important things that we should take it in consideration. First, we don't want heavy and harsh debridement that will destroy further tissues that the patient unable to cover. So we just make the wound bigger, but the ability of the wound to heal is not fixed. This is the concept come within classifying the types of the wounds to three types: either healable wounds or wounds that able to heal, or maintenance wounds. There are problems that make this wounds unable to heal, but this problem can be solved, or unhealable wounds, as the systematic factors cannot support the wound to transfer from this phase to this phase. So in the unhealable wounds, when the blood supply is problematic, when there are systematic issues rather than the nutrition or whatever, so surgical debridement is not an option. Now, the second question will be regarding to the sharp debridement or surgical debridement. Who will do it? From the foundational part, any surgery specialties can make the knife, right? They can catch the knife. Anyone, general surgery, orthopedia, whatever, they can make this knife. But to which extent to know when they should stop? What are the principles that they should follow? This required an orientation about the patient condition and the rationale for making this debridement. So we are not going to apply the sharp debridement until we see the blood, right? Is it possible for nurses to do it? Of course, if there are a proper policy and procedure and competences for train the nurses and follow up their own performance. As this is very hard option, we go for otolytic debridement. We used material and we keep this material able to make a defragmentation between the bad tissues and the good tissues, such as the hydrocolloid, alginate dressings, honey dressings, hydrogels, and polyurethanes. These options for the hydrogels mainly, it should be used with consideration for the exudate condition of the wound, as hydrogel is just more than 80 or 90% of its component in a water. So when we give the wound this amount of water, that means maybe the exudate will be higher, and this will be a problem for dealing with the wounds. This example can show up what are the role of hydrogel that can defragment the bad tissues and make it easy to be isolated and easy to be removed after. Chemical, this is the third option in the tissue management, such as silver, not any type of silver. There are some components come with the silver in combination, these dressings that come in way of cream or way of gel that able to support the tissue management, bovidine, iodine, chloroxidine, pH and B already making a good role. Hydrogen peroxide, sodium hydrochloride, but don't forget the toxicity when we are dealing with it. These categories all coming within the chemical of the tissue management. Maybe they have some impact also on the infection, but still we are discussing here its role as an debridement or supporter for removing the bad tissues. There are other less popular techniques such as larva, which when we use type of maggots, mechanical debridement, I think now it's getting much more popularity because before the mechanical debridement was known to be applied by gauze. Now there are special pads and a lot of companies now produce and develop these types of pads that able to scratch the wound, make removing these bad tissues much easy and able to be soft on the good tissues and defragment again the bad tissues that we don't want. Hydrosurgery and ultrasonic, but this need an specialized techniques and also well-trained people, and this most probably done in hospitals or specialized clinics. We finish now the T. This is the strategy that they are work in the tissue management, and after that they will go for the second letter, which is inflammation or infection. Inflammation as its term, it's already part from the wound healing process. This is normal that anyone should be inflamed until they will be able to heal. Inflammation, there are many people misunderstand the difference between inflammation and infection. Inflammation, it's come from the concept of cleaning. This is self-cleaning, what the body will do to clean this wound, to remove the bad tissues, and if there is a bacteria, so we can wash it out. Even the non-infected wounds will pass through the inflammation. But when there is bacteria start to stuck and accumulate in the wound, this is apart from the infection. In the wound bed preparation, we will see they make this more clear for how we will deal with the infected wounds. First of all, not all the infected wounds are on the same level. There are five levels for dealing with the level of bacteria or level of microorganisms over of the wound. It can be start as a contamination, colonization, localized infection, spreading infection, and systematic infection. Only in the last two phases, it start to be applicable to give the patient systematic antibiotic. But for the before of that, there is no real benefit to give the patient and exposed all the system of the patient for systematic antibiotic. The second one, on the contamination, colonization, localized infection, all of these conditions, not necessarily to be applied by one type of bacteria or one type of microorganism. So we are in need for antimicrobial action, not antibiotic action. We are in need for something that able to deal with a huge amount and varieties of bacteria on the same time. What's already suggested by that letter coming from the wound bed preparation on dealing with the antimicrobial, potassium permanganate, acetic acid, as come by socks, so it can be applied for vascular ulcers or arterial ulcers or diabetic foot. pH and B, either by wound cleansing, can be done by gel or by dressing separate. Chloroxidine, iodine, bovidine iodine, or cardamoxyl iodine, which is all had a significant antimicrobial effect, mainly on the biofilm who already enrolled in our course. They know that there are differences between normality of the infection and some condition of the infection when the bacteria start to work together to create these shields, and these shields called the biofilm. Of course, the medical grade honey or medical honey, silver and DACC. For the silver dressing, while we already mentioned here the silver, there are some important tips. Silver, there is no doubt about the strongest evidence of the role of silver as antimicrobial for the wound management. But I will just put these points for you to consider, and we will not go for much details, rather than to understand the release, the amount of silver that already able this dressing or type of dressing to release it on the wounds. How much the amount of silver that the dressings will allow to be released to the wound surface. How much this amount of wound, this amount of silver and continuity of making this release for a time of period all affect on the activity of the bacteria. What we want from the silver to kill the bacteria that in the wound surface. So the killing of bacteria need an amount of silver to be released. And this will go for another concern about the type of dressing that will used with the silver. Is it ionic type of the silver or metallic? Ionic, that the only formula that can affect the bacteria growth is the Ag plus, which is ionic, or this is called ionic, that already lost electron. But there are type of wound dressing, they use the metallic, and they will wait, they release the silver while it's metal, and they will wait until this metallic silver be ionized. There are third type of silver for wound dressing silver called crystalline silver. In this lecture, we will not go to give examples about the types of the commercial types, rather than you as a wound care expert or as a nurse or as a physician or someone interested to deal with the wounds, you should know the difference in the type of dressing that you used. You can ask the company or the people whom already manufactured. About the safety used of the silver and the duration of use. The last recommendations can discuss about the benefits of using the silver within 2 weeks. Other examples or other studies argue that the silver can be stay for more than 2 weeks, up to 1 month. So the maximum duration based on the evidence to get the benefits of silver in fighting the antimicrobial activities or to be antimicrobial agent and fight the bacteria in the wound range between 2 weeks to 4 weeks, or 2 weeks to 1 month. Also, don't forget that there are so many evidence talking about the toxicity silver, the toxicity of the silver over the patient. For me, I did not see any toxicity condition, but still the evidence describe these possibilities, and mainly on the pediatric patients and for the exposed bone also. We will go now, we finished the tea, we finished now the infection moisture, and now we will go for the moisture imbalance. The fluids come in the wounds, this is something healthy. In general, any wounds in need for this fluids to go out from the wounds, these fluids will make a rich environment for the protein, so it will enhance healing. It also will support the wound surface by antigens and white blood cells, which is all can also minimize the amount of bacterial burden or bacterial accumulation on the wound surface. But the problem coming within the chronic wounds, that the amount of enzymes can stay in these fluids can impact negatively on the ability of the wounds to solve. It will start to destroy the new tissues. It will be in a good area and environment for bacteria to grow in. And the activities of enzymes will be variant. And also the nature of fluids come within the wounds, it's affected by other systematic factors. So maybe if the patient already had a problem in nutrition, let's say that he already unable to bring the patient in need for further nutritional support, so the amount of protein will be less, so this this fluid is harming the wounds because it's not provide what the wounds need. So moisture imbalance or moisture balance would like to make a balance between the benefits and positives of availability of these fluids in the wounds. For the practical answer, we are looking to absorb this exudate. This exudate should not go out from the wounds, otherwise it will make harm for the wound edge in both cases. So this also will be in need to be think about dressings that able to absorb, on the same time absorb to the level that make the wound still moist but not exudings. There are still amounts of the fluids in the wounds. The second, the ability of this dressing to lock down and catch up the exudates and not release it under the pressure, mainly under the pressure, because when we come to talk about diabetic foot, vascular ulcer, or pressure ulcer, in all these cases, the patient may be, or the wound may be, can be under pressure. So what is the benefit of making lockdown for the fluids, but under the pressure you make it out? So we did not get the benefits that we are looking for. Some dressings also, apart from its benefits about the smell management, so it will make the quality of life for the patient better, easy to use, and safe to use. Look for this example. The only problem that here appears clearly for this wound is the bad or immoisturization or moisture imbalance. This is the wound, and it looks like there are some exudates come. The problem for the maceration, that this fluids getting out of the wound was able to destroy all that area, which is really in a very hard, bad condition, bad scenario, right? And this can be solved only by a proper moisture balance. We will come to the last letter, which is epithelial edge advancement. I think this is, I call it, this is the problematic. There are so many types of advanced dressings come on this condition. When we passed from T, I, M, and now in E, the wounds already in risk to reinfect it again. There are condition or possibilities that the wound can be flipped out or come back to previous status. So we are need to advance the healing in a way that support proper tissue granulation happen. And this should happen in a time margin that will not allow the bacteria to re-enter again to the wound. What are the examples of dressings can be applied? We have the acellular dermal matrix, such as the collagen dressings. This is apart from the first story that we took. Epidermal cells and electromagnetic therapy that can use some electromagnet fields which is support the cell granulation or cell proliferation. So we discussed here, for example, about using of collagen. Also, there are some evidence about the gas laser therapy such as helium or gallium. Anyway, this is all coming within the machine, and the manufacturers assume that this will support granulation happen or proliferation of the stem cells coming to the wound. There are evidence about the phytotherapy, ultrasonic therapy, hyperoxygen therapy, either the hyperbaric oxygen therapy or localized topical oxygen therapy, as both already provide a rich environment for the wounds to support the proliferation on the wound edge or in the epithelialization. That this is what we are looking to have in this stage. There are also an evidence about growth factors and stem cells. There are also further evidence about autologous platelet-rich plasma gel consist of cytokinase dressings. In the wound edge, we can see in the evidence about the negative pressure wound therapy. Even the main purpose, at least I use it for it, the negative pressure wound therapy, was to absorb the exudate. This is the negative pressure. But also they discovered that when they start to suck this exudate from the wounds, there are amount of blood come to the wound, and this amount of blood accelerate the proliferation. Oxygen already increased, And this all and also supporting for the stem cell to migrate to the wounds, and this accelerate the healing. So the benefits or the location of negative pressure wound therapy come mainly on the wound edge, even it's already had an impact in the moisture balance. So this is how the wounds already can be dealt with. We deal with the four letters T-I-M-E. We should classify each wound product based on its location, either on the T or I or M or E. There are also some kinds of dressings that can support the epithelialization. I will talk here about the collagen matrix. And this is how we see the map or the conceptual map for the wound products. What are the wound products and where we can locate the wound products based on its use and its type. There are type of dressings that not directly coming within this, either T or I or M or E. There is no direct benefit for this supportive dressings based on the available evidence on the wound healing, rather than it still it support the other products in making its job. And this is the supportive dressings. I will just discuss here about the contact layer, whom already trained in the wound care, they know the toxicity of using the silver on the exposed bone. Let's to say that don't use the silver over any exposed bone or tendon for many reasons. But if the wound is infected and you are looking to apply silver and the wound is infected, so you will go for contact to isolate the bone. This is also another example when we would like to isolate grafting, right, from the other environment, so you can use the contact layer. There is no direct impact of contact layer on the wounds, rather than it will support minimizing the negative impact or side effect of the other dressings. We have also the wound fillers, which is used to just fill the cavities and prevent the premature closure. So there is no any benefit for this wound filler, rather than stop happening of unwanted wound healing. Transparent films, usually I use it as a secondary support dressings to keep all of that dressings attached to the wound. So we already know about the T, I, M, E, and we classify the products, which one it's located under where. So when we deal with any, when we go to the shop or a store that full of the wound care products, I will first locate this wound product under which category. In some cases, I'm in need to manage more than one category together. So I'm in need to manage the unwanted tissue on the same time managing the infection, because we are dealing with a pizza. We are dealing with wounds that fall with everything. There are tissues I don't want. There are infection that I should manage, and there are exudates I want to make a balance. And this is give us the sandwich technique, that you can use more than one product together in a way that rationalized each one of these together. But of course, not to use anything without any rationale or just many things all together. The last statement, but not the least here, don't use the gauze. The gauze, this is something you can use it for clean the wounds. You can use it to support the dressings, but don't use it as a separate dressing. Don't leave it on the wound surface direct without any protection. It will not make any benefits. It allow the bacteria to come. When it's already getting dry and you remove it, it will bleed, make the wound bleed. So the wounds will come back to its previous status of bleeding. Also, even the granulation happen. While the gauze is already attached, you will see this like squares and so many irregular shapes. That mean even the granulation developed under the gauze is not that what you would like to have. Thank you very much for being with us. This is Abdul Karim Blasi.